as I bow to your throne. I pray for love, joy, peace, and happiness to be present in my home. Well, I do. And let the Holy Spirit dwell in my heart and in my mind. Please give me strength, 'cause I get a little weak sometimes. Need help from you just to see me through.
Heavenly Father, best of all, to you I give the glory, and on my knees I fall. And understanding, to you my praise I bring, to you my song I sing.
May I do my part to help
vindicate your name. Shalom Aleichem, once again to all of my people of Yehuda, dwelling here in these 48 states of this modern Babylon. Shalom Aleichem to Yehuda that are visiting the other two states under the rule of this de facto government that are known as Alaska and Hawaii. Especially to you, Yehuda, in Hawaii, where the Kilauea volcano is continuing to force you to return to the mainland. Shalom Aleichem to my people of Lavi, also known as Levi, also known as Haitians, that have journeyed here to these United States from Port-au-Prince, Haiti. As many of the tribe called Levi, many more are still left on that island of Port-au-Prince, Haiti, as the remnant of French slaves. Shalom Aleichem to Yisrael, the remaining 10 tribes of the children of Mine Ab, Yutubave, that are over in the Middle East today and are hiding under a cryptic name known as Syria and waiting for us to return. Judah, the rulers of Israel and of the planet Earth. Although there are some people over in the Middle East today who are calling themselves Israelis, they are masquerading as Judah, though their time of destruction is at hand. They are being punished as I speak, and they will continue to be punished and eventually destroyed out of that land. I will make them the synagogue of Satan soon, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie, realizing of course that the name Jew, the word Jew, comes from the name Judah or Yehuda. And I don't remember any of my people of Judah that were left behind in the Middle East today, especially calling themselves Israelis, where that is virtually impossible for them to be Judah, since they've just celebrated 70 years of being a state, a nation that has separated themselves from Tel Aviv and Gaza, as Jerusalem has now been made their capital. I don't know who gave them permission to do that, but they will be dealt with shortly, needless to say, but I did. Nonetheless, Shalom Aleichem to the remaining tribes, the 10 tribes of Israel. Shalom Aleichem to those of the Celestial Lodge who are unknown and only known as strangers, even as they sit among mankind today on public transportation, a public bus, a public train, a public passenger jet aircraft, even sitting next to someone eating at McDonald's, or Wendy's, shopping at Walmart. They're strangers, you don't know them. As many are being called aliens from another planet that disembarked from what NORAD called, as continues to call, a quote, UFO, end quote. Can you imagine? UFOs. Which is no such thing, by the way. That is virtually impossible. I said there is no such thing as a, quote, UFO, end quote. Of course, that stands for, quote, unidentified flying object, end quote. For thereby, how in this part of common sense can there be an, quote, unidentified flying object, an unidentified flying object, end quote, when in fact, you just identify the object as a craft or a machine that flies. So how could it be unidentified? And you just identified it as a machine that flies. And since it is true, after confessing that mankind here on Earth cannot claim all of those flying machines that are discovered by them in the Earth's atmosphere, that flies in and out of the Earth's atmosphere as crafts, that flies at speeds, as fast as over 186,000 miles per second. That's the speed of light. That means faster than that, it goes warp speed. 187,000 miles per second, of which they have not made no such aircraft here on Earth. Mankind has made no such craft here on Earth, a flying machine that could reach such a speed. And since that is the case, then that means that those flying spacecrafts can only have been made by the very same God who made them, known as mankind. And that is according to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26 of the King James Version Holy Bible, you fools. And since they were made, produced, and reproduced as, quote, mankind, end quote, then that will make them, in fact, the aliens in existence of the world. Praise Yudhwave. Nevertheless, I say Shalom Aleichem to the rest of ye beings of the Celestial Lodge, and welcome to part 2 of this special video recording as part of our telestudy series that we host 2 per week from the Celestial Lodge. And that's every Tuesday and Friday evenings at 7 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And while we're on that subject, should you care to join us, the number to dial in would be 831-221-6177. Again, that's 831-221-6177. Join us during our telestudies and learn of the God of Jacob. Learn of his law. Learn of who you are on this planet. In the meantime, let's continue on with this video that's titled Learn How to Pray in Hebrew. And at the end of part 1, we left off by proclaiming a certain thesis. So we are going to continue on that thesis as we very quickly reiterate from the end of part 1 that when the scrolls of the Hebrew prophets were originally drafted, they were done so by hand, written by the Hebrew authors in the original Hebrew idiom. And back then, Yehuda, also known as Judah today, but Yehuda, of course, that is spelled with the Yud, spelled with Yud, which is the 10th Hebrew alphabet from Aleph, that created the English's letter known as Y. Yehuda, who is known again as Judah today, that begins with a J. They were back in their own land, speaking, reading, writing, and comprehending Hebrew. And furthermore, all languages of today that are known and are being used today here on this planet, that's all 6,909 on record. That's 6,909 different languages on this planet, according to records. Where every one of them were created by Yahweh, the God of the Hebrews. Every single one of them. So this also means that the Hebrew scrolls that are all latent prophetically with their own special meanings and their own special prophecies, they were all indited. That's I-N-D-I-T-E-D. Or indite, I-N-D-I-T-E. Or should you prefer, they were orchestrated by the Almighty God, Yahweh himself. And they were done so to his Hebrew prophets, keeping in mind that Yahweh also wrote books of prophecy and promises with his own fingers. Now you can confirm this truth where it is read today in the King James Version book called Exodus in chapter 31 and verse 18. Now, with that said, you should also know that Yahweh is the master strategist. He is the master of strategy. Yahweh is a man of Milkomah. Yahweh is a man of Milkomah. Milkomah. Which is Hebrew. Milkomah. He's also the God of Milkomah. He's the God of Milkomah, Micah, Milkomah. Yahweh is the God of all Hebrew names that begins with Mem, and all Hebrew words that begins with Mem. And by the way, Milkomah is spelled from right to left with Mem. Lamed, followed by Lamed, Keth, Mem again, and Hey. That's Milkomah, as we introduced that word in part one. That means, of course, war, W-A-R, that we touched on briefly in part one. We also mentioned in part one that no matter how you spell the word, forward or backward, from right to left or left to right, it identifies whom Yahweh is, even a man of raw war. In the meantime, let's reiterate again that the Hebrew word Milkomah, which is empowered by the Hebrew character Mem, as we mentioned a moment ago, twice, it is also a variant of the celestial name that's known as Mem Yud Kaf Yud Hed Vav He of the celestial lodge. And that, in English, produces the word, the name Micah Yahweh. Micah Yahweh. And at this point, we'd also like to point out to you, as we did in part one, that Mem Yud Kaf Yud Hed Vav He also spoke. He also wrote, he read, and he comprehended Hebrew himself, even fluently back then, back in the days, as his soul journeyed here on this land, on this island, on this island, on this planet, in this country. He walked on islands, on the planet, in the Middle East, even back in the days. He walked in Africa, the whole continent. He traveled. And as he did so, he wrote, spoke, read, and comprehended Hebrew. And he was speaking Hebrew to the people. He was speaking Hebrew to Judah, his own people. It's known as Judah today, or Yehuda. That means that both Yahweh and his Christ, Mem Yud Kaf Yahweh, they spoke and still speaks. They wrote and continues to write. They read, they read, they comprehends continually Hebrew, the Hebrew idiom, even to this very day. For example, again, I would say to my people today. Ani Aleph, Ani Tav. Ani Hey, Reshif, Melek, Ani Hey, Mem Yud Kaf Yud Vav Hey. Bain Rashid, Ani Game, Gad Kates, Ashehu, Ashehaya, Ashebo, Hey, Sharai, Gador Sar Mem Yud Kaf Yud Vav Hey. I repeat. Ani Halav, Ani Tav, Ani He Rashi, Malik Ani, He, Mem Yud Kaf Yud Vav He, Bain Reshi, Ani Gam, Yed Kates, Ashehu, Ashehaya, Ashebo He, Sharai, Gador Sar Mem Yud Kaf Yud Vav He. And I am the very soul who spoke those Hebrew words to Yochanan back then, even as Yochanan and Yehuda were both speaking fluent Hebrew, and they comprehended every word I said. And the only way that my people of Yehuda, who are now sojourning from their land into these United States of these Americas, that's North, Central, and South America, the only way they can know and comprehend what I just said today in English is to read it in the Bible, or what they put in the Bible. I repeat, the only way that my people of Yehuda, who are now sojourning in these United States of America today, can know what I just said in Hebrew is for it to be translated into English translation. Though I caution my people that 90%, they can only read 90% of what I said in the King James Version Holy Bible, in the book called Revelation, chapter 1, where that is found in verse 8 of that chapter and book. Make your notes. If you make it a note, that's Revelation chapter 1 and verse 8. And the reason why I say only 90% is because the English theologians of King James 1 and of history, they all left out my celestial name. They left out mine, M-I-N-E, M-I-N-E, celestial name. And they substituted it with several erroneous names. One is the most infamous name, known as Jesus, a Spanish Greek god. A Spanish dash, Jesus, Jesus, Spanish Greek god from Europe, who's the opposite of the truth. And they also use another appellation known as Michael. And they also use one known as Yahshua. But they never knew who Yahshua is, the son of Nun, N-U-N, the 14th Hebrew alphabet, not even realizing that Nun comes after Mem, just like Nun came after Moses. And Moses never seen the promised land, never made it over to Jordan. But Nun did. Yahshua, the son of Nun, made it over and guided and led the children of Israel over. But your question in your mind should be, who is the father of Nun? Since he is the son of Nun, then who is Nun? And who is the son? Who is the father of Nun? And where is Nun, by the way? Where is Nun? N-U-N, the 14th Hebrew alphabet. Who is he? You don't know. Nevertheless, they left out 90% of what I just said and then transliterated it and placed it in English in the Bibles of England. All the English-speaking people. King James Version is the most popular. First published in the year known as 1611. So if you grab your Bible, your King James Version, should you have one, Gideon is also known to be a close replica of that book, that Bible. If you turn to Revelation chapter 1 and read verse 8, then here's what you will find. As I quote verbatim, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty, end quote. And as you should see after you read that, as many are still blind to this fact, they cannot see. Though those who can see, they will see the appellation known as Lord in lowercase letters, with one capital L, lowercase O-R-D. And that's only after the word saith, that follows Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. But one thing that you do not see, and that is the appellation of Lord and God in large and small capital letters, that are not found after the word known as, quote, Almighty, end quote, that ends that verse. In fact, why is that, you should be wondering. And here's the answer to that question. Because it was not the Almighty God or the Almighty Lord, Yahweh, that was speaking to Yochanan. It was the same one of verse 1 of the same chapter who was speaking to Yochanan. But the theologians of this world, and that's both English and the Greeks in history, even Martin Luther, the German monk, they led the whole world to believing that it was the Almighty God, Yahweh, who was speaking in that verse. Now they also took it upon themselves to add the Greeks, Alpha and Omega, to this proclamation that I spoke to Yohanan, whom they also changed his name to John. I mean, what nerve? That's a lot of nerve. That's deception. That's not the truth. How can you follow a people who is not the truth, who is not speaking the truth, who did not write the truth, who did not publish the truth, who did not lead the people into the truth? And if a people are being led in lies, then you are following a liar. However, we of the Celestial Lodge will assure you that the Christ of Yahweh is no Greek, and neither is he Caucasian from Europe. That means neither is he English. He's not even Spanish. He's not Spanish from Spain either. That means somebody lied. Somebody changed the truth of Yahweh into a lie, and they are now worshiping and serving the creature more than the Creator of Genesis chapter 1, who created them, who is blessed forever. Make a note, read it in a book called Romans chapter 1 and verse 25. You can make a note, it's there, read that. That's what they did. That means that the moral and proper transliterated version that was initially printed in English in that scroll, well, this is what should have been put in that verse. They left out 10%. That means that the popes and the monarchs of the United Kingdom, they read back in the 14th century in the care of John Wycliffe the truth of the translation. And they also read back in the 16th century another fellow by the name of William Tyndale. He wrote the translation of the truth in English from Hebrew. But here is what should have been read, that Judah also read, who knew how to speak English, before they were even kidnapped into slavery, as many of my people. They knew how to read, write. They knew how to read and write, just as they do today, English, although Hebrew is their native tongue. But here's what was said a few moments ago that came from my soul again today, that's found that very same King James Version Bible in the book called Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 8. And I read that as follows, as it was said to me, as I quote again, I am Aleph, which is the first, and I am Tav, which is the last Hebrew alphabet. Aleph is the first, and Tav is the last. I am the chief angel. I am Mem Yud Kaf Yudhuafe, Mika Yahweh, and I am Mika Yahweh from the beginning, even from Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2, even verse 1. I am the same Mika Yahweh from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, to heaven. And I am also here at the end as Mem Sophie, the last, the final Mem, which is, and which was, and which is to, which is come, the Almighty Great Prince, Micah Yahweh. That is who I am. And I send that to Yochanan, end quote. Praise Yahweh. And now that we have reminded ye and you of that proclamation, here is some celestial and spiritual advice that we are giving to you today, as we would like to remind you that in part one, you saw my moving video, my body, the body that I have today. You saw it in part one. Now, if you have not seen it, then find part one of this two-part or three-part series. Find part one of this series, and you'll see my body as it moves in that video. Right now, you are looking at photo images. You are looking at photo images of mine Ab, who came to us here in the flesh as what you thought was an ordinary man. And you see those who are familiar with this image that's in the background, as I'm pictured here with my shawl over my head, as they took a photo. They found that shroud before. They call it the shroud of, well, you know what that is. I don't have to say. I'm back. They found an old shroud, but here's the flesh. Here it is, me in the flesh of the shroud today. But in the background, you see whom many only knew and still know as, quote, Yahweh ben Yahweh, end quote, as he dwelt amongst here, amongst us here on earth in the flesh. Though that is Mount Ab, that is Yahweh. He is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. As he used that body that you see in the image for 72 years on earth. And here you see a photo image of my body that he gave me, that this soul is now being carried in today. His soul, my soul, that he gave to me, although this is his soul, but it is now walking around in this body that you see in this photo image. And although you see that, you're being encouraged not to focus on that. You're being encouraged not to focus on my body. Do not get stuck on my body. Again, do not get stuck on my body. In other words, you may be stuck on my body, but it is my soul that is speaking to your souls right now of this voice. The voice that you hear is the one that was prophesied that you will hear. The one that was read and prophesied in the book called 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16. And here's a photo image of that verse in fulfillment. The photo image that you're looking at right now is the fulfillment of that verse. And this is the voice of the archangel. I just introduced myself to you in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 8. It is my voice that you hear. Although this is actually the voice of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. He created the voice. And this is his voice that he's using here on earth right now to reach out and communicate with his children. Praise Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. So we encourage you again, do not get stuck on my body. And when I say that my soul is speaking to your souls, then I am speaking to the seed of Yahweh that was placed in the loins of Abraham, that is read in Genesis chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. Or did you not know that before Genesis chapter 15 that Abraham was not able to have any children? Or did you not know that in Genesis chapter 15, mine Ab, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, caused a deep sleep to fall upon Abram, just as he did Adam, who you know as Adam, and he, while he was under anesthesia, while he was in a deep sleep, mine Ab took his own sperm from his own body and placed his sperm in the loins of Abraham, or Abram. And that is why when you read verse 15, actually verse 13 of Genesis chapter 15, when you read verse 13 of Genesis chapter 15, that said that Yahweh spake unto him, that his seed should sojourn. Who do you think his seed is? The world was led to believe that that seed was Abram's seed. No, it was not. Mine Ab said his seed, speaking of his personal self, his seed should be a stranger in the land and sojourn. And here they are today. The seeds of Yahweh that was placed in the loins of Abraham. In fact, to every seed, Yahweh gave that seed, which is the same as a terrestrial body. It's a celestial seed, a soul, but Mount Ab gave that seed, that celestial seed, a celestial soul, a terrestrial body. So we have now, walking on this planet, celestial souls walking around in terrestrial bodies, and you talking about alien. You are the aliens, mankind, you white boys. You white boys from Europe, you are the aliens. We are the ones who created you and made you in Genesis chapter 1 and verses 26, 27. Male and female we made of you, and we gave you permission to be fruitful and multiply. How in the world did you think that was Adam and his wife, Eve, or his woman actually? She destroyed the wifehood when she laid with Lucifer, or Halel. As you only know him as Lucifer, the great dragon, the serpent. You only know him today as a red dragon, Pharaoh. His soul is back too. Since his soul is back, what makes you think the Christ soul can't be back with him? It's all prophecy and revelation. Wake up. Wake up and realize what's happening around you today. I'm speaking to the souls that are in another body today. This is not the first time that your soul has been in the body. But to every seed, mine Ab gave that seed his own body, their soul, and her body too. There are women too. You have your own body. You walk around in a body. Now with that said, you are being encouraged right now to stop focusing on your body. As I just told you to stop focusing on my body. Although this body was given a soul, this body is capturing a soul and walking around with a soul, and so is your body walking around with a soul. This body is merely sheltering and protecting the soul, as your body is also protecting your soul. Take care of it. It's no guarantee that you're going to get another one. These are the last days. This world is about to end. In fact, this world is ending as I speak. Praise Yahweh. And the reason why we showed you the moving body, my moving body in part one, even as you see the still shot here, a photo image, in part two. Well, that was done so that every eye can see me. Right now on this www website that they call YouTube. And just as promised, it was promised that would happen. How else would every eye be able to see me who tune in? Every eye on the planet, those who know of YouTube and Facebook, they tune right into this website, www, YouTube, Facebook. They tune right in. Praise Yahweh. So how else would that prophecy be fulfilled if this had not been provided for them in 1947? That we left this technology here on earth for them, as Mount Ab control landed that spacecraft that they found in Roswell, New Mexico in the first week of July of 1947. Go look it up. They called it a UFO, a spacecraft. They even made a movie of it. But we left that spacecraft here so you can make the technology to fulfill prophecy. And this is one of them. Of Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, that every eye shall see me, and I'm the same one, even those that pierce me, especially those that pierce me. I am the same soul whom they crucified over 2,021 years ago, right there in Golgotha, right, Calvary, and my own people crucified me. Stop blaming it on the Romans. There's no such thing. It's a lie. And my body was not nailed to no cross with no nails in my hand and my feet. That's a lie. My own people stoned me to death. They stoned me to death because they thought I was going around calling myself Yahweh, just as they're doing today. They don't even know the difference between the Father, Ab, and the Son, the Father and the Son, or the Christ. They think I'm going around calling myself Yahweh because I'm the only one on this planet in existence, in the universe, that has the name that I just introduced to you. Mem, Yud, Kaf, Yud, Hey, Vav, Hey. And it's not a name. That is a septuplet of angels. I'm just the God of them. I'm the God of the earth of the septuplets, the seven angels. And those seven angels were actually five. Two sets of those angels are twins. That's five, of which two are positioned twice to become twins of the first set. And that's Yud and He have twins. And they are from right to left. Mem, Yud, Kaf, Yud, He, Vav, He. Those are seven angels, and I'm the God of them. And I'm the God of water, Mem. Now I'm the same one whom they crucified by stoning that body that my Ab gave me back then. They stoned it, and then after they stoned it to death and destroyed it, then they took that body and hung it on a tree so that all of Israel can see it. And someone came and stuck a spear under my right rib. They took a spear and jerked my under my right nipple under my rib. And mine Ab showed the whole planet today, the whole world, so that they would know the truth and make no mistake that it would be me. Because there would be a lot of people on this planet with doubt that it's me. Well, what he did, mine Ab did, was he put a birthmark on this body right under my right nipple of a shape of a spear. A birthmark in the shape of a spear right under my right nipple, just where it was poked and stabbed with blood coming out. And if you want to see it, then come see me. I'm not going to show it on www. I don't have to prove it to you. I'm not here to convince you or to prove anything to ye. I'm not here to convince ye or prove anything to you. But if you can find me in Miami of Florida, there are several Miamis in this country, different states. But if you find me in the Miami of Florida, and I will show you, I will lift up my shirt and show you my birthmark on this body that's carrying this soul under my right nipple, right by the rib cage. Praise you to Walk Her. I challenge you. I also invite you. I invite you too, Judah, to come home to your God. I'm here for you. I have returned for Judah. In fact, Azan Shema. Azan Shema. She'erish Yesh. Azan Shema. Ye Yehuda, Yaakov, Yisrael. Torah Rabakara, Boel Slon Elohim, Yudawafe. Azan Slon Elohim, Yudawafe, Nathan 8. Judah, don't you know what I said? If you did not know, if you do not know, then you are dead. That's your language. That's Hebrew. Didn't you hear it? I repeat. Azan Shema. She'erish, Yesh, Azan, Shema, Ye, Yehuda, Yaakov, and Yisrael, Torah, Rabba, Kara, Boel, Slon, Elohim, Yudhavavhe, Azan, Slon, Elohim, Yudhavavhe, Nathan, 8th. Well, you don't know what I said because you're dead. You hang around the English band too much, too long. Over 464 years, hanging around the white slave master, taught you English. The only way that you can understand what I just said or comprehend is if I said unto you, peace be unto ye. Hear, hearken to the remnant. Hear, hearken ye the remainder that there is of Judah, Jacob, and Israel. Thank you for calling. You are welcome to come to your God, Yahweh. Hear, hearken to your God, Yud-Heh-Wav-Heh. The time has come. I am the very soul who taught your soul over 2,050 years ago how to pray to your Ab, Yud-Heh-Wav-Heh, who art in heaven, in Hebrew. And to prove it, I did the very same thing today by placing a recording of that very same voice that you hear now, this very same voice that you hear right now, on a free teleconference telephone line, that all you had to do was to call that number, call a number, and listen to the recording and learn your prayer in Hebrew. But they discarded it. Actually, they took it upon themselves to do something with the number, with the free telephone number. But your question should be, why did I do that? Why did I put it on a free, at what started to be a free teleconference line? Well, because we knew then that Yehuda, we knew from way back in the beginning, that Yehuda will go through a time period and forget how to pray in Hebrew, especially our tefillah, which is infamously known as, quote, the Lord's Prayer, end quote, in English. But that prayer originated from our own Hebrew tongue. In fact, when you now call that same number that I provided a couple years ago, then you discover the rulers of this world that owns those certain cellular phone companies, free conference lines, has now taken it upon themselves to make it very difficult for my people to call free. They added a charge on your cell phone carrier. Well, it's your cell phone carrier that's charging you. This is one of several reasons why we are now reaching out to our people by way of this video website company known as YouTube, who will receive a blessing should they be obedient to the order and do not erase or omit this video. And we pray that they're watching it, at least the prototypes, when they listen and watch this video, that they do not erase it or omit it and allow it to go to my people. If they do, they will not have an estranged woman or even an estranged terrorist man. They will not have anyone to come on their properties again out in California and shoot it up. They will not. That will not happen. We will not cause you to flee. We will bring peace to your company in California. You got that? But if you do not, then I'm going to deploy one of my angels to fly over from where I'm at, from the East Coast to the West Coast, and pay you a visit. You would call it, you would think it's a UFO. You only know it as a UFO. And that is not a threat. That is a promise, just like prophecy. We pray that you got that. Anyway, prototypes of YouTube out in California, when you get this message, allow this video to go viral. And if you are in church, when you come out of church, pray. You can come out and learn how to pray. With us, you can pray. Hebrew, you were taught the wrong prayer in church. Mine Ab is not the God of England. So when you pray the Lord's Prayer in English, he is not hearing you. It's not meant for you anyway. Anyway, as I continue on this part two, as you watch this video, you hear the voice of Yahweh. You should be hearing my voice very clearly now, and free. Free of charge, just like promised in Isaiah chapter 52 and verse 3. You shall be redeemed without money, Yehuda. Even Yehuda Yahweh. We're going to get to that in a moment. So as we now begin to teach you, we're going to guide you. You must now go to your Bible, your King James Version Bible, and turn to the first book of the New Testament that's called Matthew, as we begin to teach you how to pray in Hebrew. So go to Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to start at verse 1. So grab your Bible, take a moment to grab your Bible, as we now go to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to read verse 1, so pay very close attention, Judah. Pay very close attention. Grab your Bible. And now that you should have your Bibles. You should have your Bible turned to the first book of the New Testament. That is called Matthew. And as we pray, as Hebrew Israelites, the children of Yudavavheh, although we are in the West, the land of the West, and of bondage, you must face the direction of the East, your homeland. You must face the direction of the altar that Solomon built, that was built for Yudavavheh, that's located in the East. And as you prepare to pray, you must do the opposite of what you were taught by your slave masters and the lying devils. You were taught opposite of how you are to pray. What is the opposite? The opposite is falling down on your knees, getting on your knees, off of your feet, folding your hands together, and bowing your head to the ground, to the devil, and closing your eyes so that you cannot see what he's getting ready to do to you. That is how he taught you to pray. On your knees to be whipped, fold your hands together to be tied, bow your head to the ground so it can be cut off, and close your eyes so that you cannot see the sword coming upon your head. He don't want you to see what he's getting ready to do. But you must be resurrected, Judah, Yehuda. You must stand on your two feet. You must stand and spread your arms apart with the elbows bent at a 45 degree angle, and your palms should be facing outward so that Mem can be seen in both of your palms. Mem is engraved in the palms of your hand. Mem, M, in both. And the fingertips should be at the top level of your head, and your eyes should be open, and your head should be tilted upward toward heaven, where your Ab is, your Father in heaven, Ab in Hebrew. That's where he is, not on the ground. He's up, not down. Your eyes should be open so that you can see him, seek his face. And before you do, though, where should you do it? Well, look at verse 1 of Matthew chapter 6. Before you do that, take heed. It says, quote, take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. That's verse 1. So what does that mean? Well, the very word that you see here in English of this verse, alms, spelled from left to right, A-L-M-S, it's read in this first verse. It was taken from the original Hebrew word known as kashed. And this word kashed in Hebrew, it means a reproach of shame. It means a reproach of shame. So you most definitely will be praying to your Ab because you have a reproach of shame. So in other words, when you read that again, with that meaning of alms in Hebrew, kashed, then you should take heed that you do not your alms or you do not your reproach of shame before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Ab, Aleph Beth, which is Father in Hebrew, Yudavavheh, which is in heaven. Now read verse 2. Verse 2 says, therefore, when thou doest thine reproach and shame, do not sound a trumpet before thee. What does that mean? That means do not announce to everyone in your surroundings that you're getting ready to pray, even in your own house. It don't mean that because you're in a band, you know how to play a trumpet, that you go sound it off in the streets. That's not what that means. So come out of the street with your trumpets and your horns. Let everybody know what you're getting ready to do. Stop it. It means Do not let anyone in your surroundings, or do not announce in advance that you're getting ready to pray. Even in your own house, do not announce it, what you are about to do. Why? Well, read and see why. You know, who are going to be like that, or who is good at that? They're doing that today. Read and see who is good at doing that right now, today. But says what? As the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets. See, that's who's doing it. You want to be like the hypocrites in the synagogues? The hypocrites? Are you a hypocrite? Why? That they may have glory of men. That's why they do it. They're looking for glory from other men and women. Most women, they're looking to impress the women. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. Verse 3. But when thou doest your redemption, your reproach and shame to your Yahweh, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth. Wow, what does that mean? That means do not even let your best friend know what you're about to do, what you're about to do. Don't let your spouse know if you're married, that's husband and or wife, or even your parents. Don't let your parents know, or parents, if you are blessed or fortunate to have both parents today, as well as your siblings, brothers and sisters. Do not let them know what you're about to do, that you're about to pray to your Yahweh. Do not let them know. They may hinder you. They may discourage you from doing it. Verse 4 says, that thine reproach and shame may be in secret. And why? And thy father, thy Ab, which seeth in secret himself, shall reward ye thee openly. Isn't that a blessing itself? There's your blessing already before you even pray. That he see you in secret, he bless you openly. And verse 5, and when thou prayest, thou should not be as the hypocrites do or are. Why? For they love to pray, standing in the synagogue and in the corners of the streets, and you see them dressed in red, white, bull horns out, signs around their neck, repent, Jesus is coming. You see them out there. Why? That they may be seen of men. That's why they do it. So verily I say unto you, they have their reward. So now you got hypocrites, and you have those in the streets, still hypocrites, hypocrisy. Look at verse 6. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. Now stop. Look at it. Some are running to the closet already before I can even finish the verse. You think it's the closet where thou hast shut thy door. You pray to thy father which is in secret, and thy father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Here you are running into the closet, right in your house. That's not what that means. So what does it mean by going into your closet? And this is not the closet that is in your bedroom or your linen closet in the hallway where you keep your sheets, towels, and pillowcases. Oh no, that's not the closet. This is a figure of speech. This is a figurative statement. Figuratively. See, this closet, as you are reading today in English translation, it came from the original Hebrew word known as kappa. Kappa. And this word kappa in Hebrew, it means divine protection. Divine protection. In other words, go from place, go someplace, go from a place where it's noisy and a lot of people, hindrance, family, husband, wife, go from their presence. Stay out of the street. Don't go in the corner. Don't go outside. Go to a private place, a place in privacy, within the confinement of your own dwelling structure, whether it be a house or an apartment, even a rooming house. If you must, go in the bathroom. Or if you're at work, if you have a room at work, if you're working and you have the key and you can lock it, go in that room. Or in school, find a private place in school if it's a place you need to pray or you want to pray, your redemption, your shame and reproach. If possible, find those places, at all possible, that you will have kappa, or you will have divine protection in that place while you are praying. You need protection while you are praying. Now look at verse 7. Verse 7 says, "But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions." What does that mean? What is that? Well, look, it's two words. What does vain mean? What is vain? Vain. Well, vain means ineffective, hopelessness, unsuccessful, unproductive, and worthlessness. That's what vain is. You're doing it all in vain. Might as well not even pray. So what's repetitions? Repetition means the action of repeating something that has already been said over and over and over again. Why would you do that? Well, you think your God, Yahweh, is deaf? I mean, he's the one who created ears, the eardrum. You have three ears. You have six ears, three on each side. Did you know that? Now, if he gave you six, what do you think he has? He's God. What do you mean? I have six ears. I'm looking at one. Really? Well, what about your outer ear, the middle ear, and your inner ear? Did you know about that? That's three on each side. You have an outer ear that's visible. You have a middle ear that you cannot see. That's where the drum is stored, the drum. And then you have an inner ear where it takes it to the brain, your soul, so you can hear. The only thing you can do with the outer ear is listen. You can only listen with your outer ear, and then when you listen to something, it relays it to the middle ear and let it know it now is absorbed sound. And then it must reach the inner ear so it can identify the sound of what's being said. And then that will register it to your soul, your mind of comprehension. So what do you think? Your father is deaf? You have to repeat it over and over and over again? Sort of like reoccurrences of something that you asked for just yesterday, and duplications of the same thing, even reiterations and reappearances. That's what you think, to name a few. In other words, do not pray to Yahweh by repeating something that ye already prayed for, especially over and over and over again, that becomes a recurrence of the same thing that you asked for all week. That would make you look insane. You would look insane as if you think Yahweh did not hear you or comprehend your prayer. And because you think that vain thought would cause you to duplicate, reiterate, and reappear before him as stupid. And that is not necessary. Because if you do that, then you will fall into other groups. If you do that, then I guarantee you're going to fall into another group that's read in the next sentence of verse 7. So read that and see what that is. See who they are. Which are who? As the heathen do. See? I mean, you are between a rock and a hard place. You got a hypocrite on one side, and now you're in the middle, and you got a heathen on the other side. So what are you going to do? Be a hypocrite or heathen? See, the heathens are the ones who do over and over again, lighting candles, putting bears on the fence, on the sidewalk, for they think they shall be heard, holding hands in a circle with candles, for they're much speaking, just because they say it over and over again, every day. See? We pray that you can see this. Now read verse 8. Verse 8 says what? Be not ye therefore like unto them. I repeat, be not ye therefore like unto them. For your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. You got that? And after you do all of that passage, when you do all of that passage from verse 1 to 8, now what do you need to do? What do you do? Well, read verse 9. And we're going to read verse 9 to get instruction in English. It says what? After this manner, therefore, pray ye, says in red and English, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. End quote. Is that what you think your Ab is going to listen to? No, that's not so. Why? Because the English's version is not what we taught ye how to pray, our tefillah in Hebrew. I mean, it's almost verbatim from the original Hebrew in translation, but not quite. And although the English translation of our tefillah is not easily able to be transliterated into English, this version is close to the King James Version. But again, I caution you, this is not our prayer. Why? Because our prayer is personal to our Ab, Yahweh, from us. And it's meant for no other nations of earth to recite but us. And that is why I must teach you how to pray in our original Hebrew tongue, Yehudi Yahweh and Yishwa Yahweh. That way, ye and you will be recognized and respected by all other nations as a Hebrew Israelite. And since that is the case, then let me now recite for ye our tefillah in Hebrew, beginning at verse 9, as I taught ye before, as follows. So pay attention. Avenu Shabashamayim, Yikadesh Shemeakar, Tarvo Malku Teakar, Yaseh Rezonka, Kivashamayim, Kain Ba'aretz, Ez Lekem Kukenu, Tain Lanu Hayom, Uslak Lanu, Al Kateinu Kimoshesokin, Gamunatnu, Lakote Em Lanu, Ve'al Tevienu, Lade Nisayom, Kim Kal Senu, Min Hara, Kilakar Hamamlaha, Ve'ha Givara, Ve'ha Tif Eret, Le'olame, Olamim, Selah. Now, did you hear that? See, did your outer ear was only listening. Your inner ear grabbed hold to it, but your inner ear could not absorb it and comprehend it. Again, your outer ear was listening. Your middle ear grabbed hold to it, but your inner ear could not comprehend it. Why? Because you forgot Hebrew. So once again, I'm going to recite that again, but this time I'm going to go a second or two intervals in between so you can follow after me, repeat after me, recite after me your tefillah. And that way, when your outer ear listens, your middle ear will grab hold to it, and your inner ear will grab it and take it, and your soul can learn it again. So here it is. Follow after me. I will go slower with intervals of a second or two. So repeat. Avenu Shabashamayim Yikadesh Shemeakar Tarvo Malku Teakar Yase Rezonkar Kivashamayim Kain Ba'aretz Etlekem Kukenu Tain Lanu Hayom Uslak Lanu Al Kateinu Kimoshesokim Gamunatnu Lakote Ein Lanu Veal Tevienu Lade Nisayon Kim Kal Senu Min Hara Kilakar Hamamlaha Veha Givara Vehatif Eret Leolame Olamim Selah. Praise Yahweh, Shivak Yahweh, glory, hallelujah Yahweh, all praises be to our God Yahweh. So now, if you did not get it that time, your inner ear by now should be grabbing hold to it. But if not, remember, this is a video. Put it on pause or rewind and play it over again, over and over again, till you learn it in your soul. You relearn it of course, not learn it. You have to just relearn it. I'm bringing it back to your remembrance. In the meantime, remember, you can use this video and play it back and learn from this video how to pray our prayer in Hebrew. And don't forget it. Why? Why is it so important? Why is it so very important in the first place for you to learn your personal prayer? The Tefillah. Here's why. Because your Ab, Yudawafe, promised ye in Isaiah chapter 52 and verse 3 that ye shall be redeemed without money. Why? Because all the riches of earth cannot buy you or ye what has been charged to you and to ye that is found today and read in the book called Second Chronicles of the Old Testament. So turn to that. Second Chronicles chapter 7. All of the riches in the world cannot help you with this charge. That's why you must be redeemed without money. And you're going to go to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, and you're going to see why it's so important to pray in Hebrew and toward the altar that Solomon built. In fact, look at verse 14 of that chapter. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. And that reads, as I quote, "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land," end quote. Now you know that our land needs healing today. Look at what's happening in our land today. The Satans, those of the synagogue of Satan, are tearing it up. Bombshells all over the place, buildings riddled with bullets, AK-47s, even AR-15s from the U.S. military guns, wars, I mean mortar shells all in the ground and the earth, buildings burnt. I mean, it's a mess. Don't you agree? Do you not agree that our land needs healing? Well, you must pray for that healing of our land, just as it says here in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. And I want you to also notice that in this verse, Yudawafe emphasized, quote, "my people, which are called by my name," end quote. And those people in the Middle East are not called, being called by your Ab's name, by our Abba's name. Our Ab's name is Yudawafe. Even as Israelites, those people that are calling themselves Israelites, they are Israelis. So you know something's wrong with that picture. But who are these people that are called by the name Yudawafe? And not only that, but look at what proceeds the word "if." My people, which are called by my name. But what about if? I mean, we cannot forget about the very first word of the scripture, if. Why? Why is "if" placed there? Because all of Yudawafe's people are not going to humble themselves. At least two parts of all the land that shall be cut off and die, they are not going to humble themselves. And that's according to Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 8. Read that. Two parts of all the land shall be cut off and die. Not just cut off, they're going to die. They must love death. Those are suicidal people. So that's what is promised. And that's why they will not humble themselves. If, that's why "if" is placed there. Now, that means, and not only that, many of our people are not going to want to seek the face of Yahweh, as it says, as the rest will not come and return to him to accept his name. That is, in their name. Just as the new names are revealed in this video that some has never heard before, that I have now given to those who returned. And that those names, two names, which are the ruling tribe, Yud-Heh-Wav-Dalet, Yud-Heh-Wav-Heh. Again, Yud-Heh-Wav-Dalet, Yud-Heh-Wav-Heh. And that's the same as Yehuda-Yahweh. That's the old Judah, formerly known as Yehuda, and now today known as Judah. Again, Yud-Heh-Wav-Dalet, Yud-Heh-Wav-Heh, Yehuda-Yahweh, formerly known as Yehuda, today known as Judah. And the second is You sheen resh alef yudet wafe. You sheen resh alef yudet wafe. Yishwa Yahweh. Formerly known as Yisrael or Yisrael. And today known as Israel. But that's Yishwa Yahweh. And both names have the name Yahweh in there. That means those people are called by his name. That's Yehuda, Yahweh, the ruling tribe, and Yishra, Yahweh, the rest of the 11 tribes. And Zechariah chapter 13, verse 8 also takes care of the word if. However, Zechariah chapter 13, verse 9 are those of my people and are those of his children who, at one time during the history of this world, all 12 tribes spoke fluent Hebrew and they prayed the prayer. But today, there are two tribes of the 12 who forgot their Hebrew tongue, and those evil, wicked English slave masters of these United States are getting rich off of Yudawafe's poverty-stricken ghetto-dwelling people. I mean, they are, my people are poverty-stricken, ghetto-dwelling people, and the rich man, the white man, is getting rich off of them, insomuch until it now causes mine own people to put their funds, all their paychecks and monies, some rob stores and people and businesses and restaurants just to get extra money to buy cell phones and cars and cosmetics. So much rouge on their face you can't even tell who the person is. They got it from Egypt, the Egyptians. Better read Jeremiah chapter 3. Tattoos. I mean, my dark-skinned people, black-skinned, dark-skinned, brown-skinned people, putting red, green, yellow tattoos on their body that you can't even see. And some have more tattoos than skin on their body that you, oh my goodness. Buying hair. My own people, the woolly-headed, nappy-headed people of earth, have hair like lamb, like sheep, cutting it off and then buying somebody else's hair from India. What in the world has happened to you, Judah? I mean, I actually see people sitting up in a salon and spend $400 to $500 on a hairdo. $400 to $500 with a weave or with somebody else's hair just to go to a wedding or a party or the prom. Shoes and tennis shoes. Buying tennis shoes with somebody else's name on them instead of making some of your own and put your name on them. What is wrong with you, Judah? And see, that now causes them to favor the word if of 2 Chronicles 7:14. But if we want to be delivered, then ye must get past if of 2 Chronicles 7:14 to become the third part of Zechariah 13:9. And by the way, that reads, quote, and I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, Yud-Heh-Waf-Heh is my God, end quote. And the only way he would know it is his people, the only way mine Av would know it is his people, if you accept him and come back and grab your name as I've given it to you, as promised, according to Revelation chapter 2 and verse 17. Read it. Revelation 2:17. There's a new name that the manna will feed you that no man knew. The only one who knew it was the one who signified it and sealed it. It was told to seal it and then come back and loose it and give it to you today. I told you I am that very soul. But you do not have to believe me or amend me. I'm not here to convince you.